أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ووصينا الإنسان بوالديه حملته أمه وهنا على وهن وفصاله في عامين أن اشكر لي ولوالديك إلي المصير وإن جاهداك على أن تشرك بي ما ليس لك به علم فلا تطعهما وصاحبهما في الدنيا معروفا واتبع سبيل من أناب إلي ثم إلي مرجعكم فأنبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we continue with chapter 31 in the Quran, Surah Luqman. And in the previous session, we discussed the advice of Luqman, the first advice of Luqman to his son, and that is, لا تشرك بالله إن الشرك لظلم عظيم. Do not associate a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that is the greatest form of oppression. Now the verse moves on, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ, moves on to talk about one of the most important messages of not only the religion of Islam but all religions. And it is a very important message in the Quran, a value that the religion of Islam insists upon. And in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in numerous occasions in the Quran talks about this. Allah talks about it immediately after talking about the importance of believing in the one and only God and not associating a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this shows that this is a very important topic, a very important subject. What is it? It is birr al-walidain, respecting, honoring, and showing respect to parents. So the following verse, immediately after the verse of not associating a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, comes the verse of respecting parents. Allah says in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. And we have commanded, we have enjoined upon man care for his parents. His mother carried him, increasing in her weakness upon weakness, and his weaning is in 2 years. Be grateful to me and to your parents. To me is the final destination. So when we analyze the Quranic verses that talk about parents and the rights of the parents, we see that in many occasions, in several occasions where they are mentioned, they come immediately after believing in the one and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not associating a partner with God. This is one instance in Surah Luqman, chapter 31, where Allah says in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ, immediately after, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. So the first piece of advice was associating a partner is a great act of injustice. Now the next order, the second most important order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to respect and love the parents. And here, one of the scholars of the Quran, exegetes of the Quran, Al-Allama al-Tabatabai, in his book Tafsir al-Mizan, he says that this portion, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ, this was not the advice of Luqman to his son. He said that this is actually God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, interjecting and telling us the importance of respecting parents, because immediately before that, the concept of tawheed and not associating a partner with God was mentioned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, God, this is the advice of Luqman. He's telling his son, don't associate a partner with God. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before carrying on with the other advices, pieces of advice of Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but wait, immediately after not associating a partner with God, we will command you. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. And this is a wasiyah, this is a command from God. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. So here, it's because of the importance of the message, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala interjects and adds this piece of advice in the middle of a series of advice that Luqman is giving his son. So this is one in Surah Luqman, immediately after not associating a partner with God, you have the order of respecting parents. Second, in Surah Isra, chapter 17 in the Quran, verse 23 of chapter 17, Allah says in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَن لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And your Lord has decreed that you do not worship anyone other than Him. You do not associate a partner with God. And the next immediate order, and this shows how important it is in terms of priorities, the next order is وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, and that you show ihsan, you show kindness towards your parents. In Surah Ankabut, the spider, verse 8, Allah says in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ لِتُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. Despite the fact that not associating a partner with God is so important and tawheed is so important, Allah says, even though shirk is the greatest sin, associating a partner with God is the greatest sin, and the one who does that is the greatest oppressor, it's dhulmun azim, but if your parents are associating a partner with God, you still have to respect them. You still have to show them kindness. And this is a recurring theme throughout the Quran. You always see the prophets doing dua for their parents. وَلِوَالِدَيْ. You see, always there's a command to show love and respect to the parents and show kindness to the parents. Now, someone might ask, why does the Quran constantly remind us this? And although the Quran does order parents to raise children properly and care for children, and it does give us those commands as well, but they're nothing compared to the commands of the children having to respect their parents. So you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala focuses on this so much. Why? It's because oftentimes people forget. Oftentimes people get too caught up with their lives that they forget the closest people to them, their own parents. You forget the ones who cared for you the most, the ones who made you who you are, the ones who loved you the most, an unconditional love. Those are your parents. Your parents who accepted you for who you are. Your parents who had sleepless nights because of you. They love you the most. But you find that many times, the parents don't need a reminder to take care of their children. It's a natural instinct to care for your children and worry about your children. But sometimes you find that the children, and even once they're older, once they're busy, once they're, you know, successful, once they have a job, at that time, many times they tend to forget their parents. They forget about the closest people to them. So this is why the Quran constantly reminds us. This is why the Quran is constantly telling us, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. We have commanded you, we have enjoined you. This is something, it's such an important order when it comes to the religion of Islam. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. So Allah says in the Quran, and we have enjoined the human being to take care of your parents. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an example of the mother, because the Quran acknowledges that your mother has exhausted herself much more than your father. Now you have to respect both, And you have to love both, and you have to show ihsan to both. But the Quran takes us back to the mother. It is your mother who had sleepless nights because of you. It is your mother who her body was changed because of you. It is your mother who fed you from her own body, from her own soul. She gave you her heart. She gave you everything. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنًا. The mother, Allah describes the weakness and the pain that the mother has while she's carrying and while she's giving birth and while she's feeding and while she's raising. A lot of times we grow and we forget the pain that our mothers went through to carry us for 9 months, and then to feed us, and then the birth and the labor and delivery, and then dealing with raising us and the problems that we give our parents. A lot of times we forget that. You find some people, as soon as they get the car keys, as soon as they become a little bit successful, or they get a degree, they have a job, they forget their parents and they forget their mother, and they look down upon their own parents. Allah says, حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنًا. In weakness. And that weakness creates more weakness. Your mother gave birth to you. That exhausted her body. That took a toll on her body. And maybe later on, you find her bones are weak. Maybe later on, you find that she's weak. This is because you sucked out that energy from her. That pregnancy had a toll on her. When she was feeding you, it had a toll on her body. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to remember that. حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنًا. And then Allah says in the Quran, وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ. And 2 years. 2 years, that's the average amount. That's the time that a mother is feeding you, changing your diaper, caring for you, breastfeeding you, giving you all of that. At least 2 years. وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ. And then Allah says in the Quran, أَنْ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرِ. You want to be a mu'min? You want to be a believer in God? You have to, as the verses pointed out, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنْ اشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ. You want the wisdom, you have to thank God. But now Allah says in the Quran, but wait, it's not only thanking God, you have to thank your own parents. أَنْ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ. You have to thank me and thank your parents. إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ. You all come to me. So here, the Quran teaches us something very important, a very important point. And that is that my appreciation and my gratitude is not only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, we have to first and foremost appreciate and show thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if I want to maximize that appreciation, if I want to show the best appreciation to my family, to God, then I have to thank my parents. I have to respect my parents. I have to show ihsan to my parents. And this is what it means to be a Muslim. And ishkur li, God says, thank me and thank your own parents. This is what makes you a believer. If someone is praying and fasting and always thanking God, but they neglect their own parents, then there is a question mark on this person. Then this person will have serious issues if they have problems with their parents. No matter how much good you've done, you have to respect and appreciate your parents and give them the proper respect that they deserve. And of course, according to the religious teachings, Islamic teachings, is that we will never be able to fully appreciate our parents. Never. A man, he carries his mother on his back and he performs the Hajj. At that time, they had no wheelchairs. And the Hajj is exhausting. It's exhausting for a person to walk and do the Hajj on your own. Now imagine having to carry your mother on your back. His mother was paralyzed. So he carries his mother in the Tawaf, in the Sa'i, in the Muzdalifa, in Mina, in Arafat. For anyone who's been to Hajj, they know it's very tiring. He does all of that and his mother is on his back. And she's also performing the Hajj. Then he comes to Rasulullah. He tells him, Ya Rasulullah, I carried my mother for this whole period on my back. Will God compensate me? Will God, have I done enough for my mother? Have I fulfilled my duty and my task to my mother? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him, you have not done enough, no. And you will never be able to fully compensate your mother and pay your mother back. You'll never be able to do that. You find some people, their parents are at an older age and they take care of their parents for many years, probably 5 years, 6 years, 10 years, whatever the case may be. Some of them, they probably think to themselves, my parents, they raised me for 3-4 years. And then I grew up and I started walking, I started using the restroom on my own, I started doing this and that. But now I'm taking care of my parents for this whole time. I've definitely paid them back. The answer is no. Even despite that, when we are caring for our parents at an older age, we have never paid them back. Because when your parents were taking care of you when you were young, when you were an infant, when you were a newborn, when you were so vulnerable, they were seeing a bright future for you. They were hoping for you to live long, to attend your wedding. They were hoping for you to be successful. They were hoping for you to have, they were having dreams for you. But when you are taking care of your ill mother or your ill father, is that, are you having the same dreams for your parents as they were having for you? Many times people, they say, this is a test from Allah. It's going to finish quickly. Let me be patient. They're going to leave this life soon. We're not having the same dreams for our parents as they had for us. And this is because, this is why we could never pay them back. And then Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. And if they have ordered you, if they're struggling and they're telling you to worship another god, to be a mushrik, Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. If they're telling you to worship something that you have no knowledge of, what does scholars here, they say, مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. This is talking about idol worship. It has no substance. It has no, it's not based upon knowledge. So therefore, Allah says, مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. Something that you have no knowledge of, something that you don't even agree to, فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. Don't obey them. Don't obey them in when they are telling you to do something wrong. And here, the religion of Islam tells us that every person, they have to make their own decision. Your religion should not be the religion of your parents. Even if you're a Muslim, you have to become a Muslim based on conviction, based on faith, based on certainty. You have to be convinced that this is the right religion. So if your parents are forcing you to obey and worship and associate a partner with God, something that you have no knowledge of, don't obey them. You don't have, kindness is one thing, and blind obedience to parents is something else. Yes, we are ordered, we are requested to show kindness to our parents, to show ihsan, to take care of our parents. However, that does not mean that you are an independent thinker. And if they are telling you to do something wrong, then you do not obey. لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. This is a general principle. Even if your parents, whoever it may be, if they're telling you to do something haram, they're telling you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then in this case, you do not obey them. In this case, you do not obey them. However, Allah says in the Quran, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. But you still have to take care of them. You still have to show that compassion, show that love, show that attachment to them, take care of them, provide for them. And why were these verses being revealed? Because many of those who were newly joining the religion of Islam during the time of Rasulullah, their parents were idol worshippers. Their parents were stubborn. So what does the religion of Islam say? The religion of Islam says, even if they're idol worshippers, you still have to take care of them. You still have to show them ihsan. You still have to show them that love and take care of them. Because this is, if you want to show appreciation to God, then you have to show appreciation to your parents, no matter what religion they're on. A man by the name of Zakariya ibn Adam, during the time of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He was a Christian man. He converts to the religion of Islam. But then he comes and he tells the Imam, my mother is Christian. My mother is not a Muslim. What should I do with my mother? How should I live in the same house with my mother? The Imam tells him, you take care of your mother. You have to honor her. Now you have to do more. And you should not, just because you're Muslim does not mean that she's not your mother anymore. Does not mean that you do not have to show love and respect to her. So this man, Zakaria ibn Adam, he goes back to his city and he starts taking care of his mother. He starts showing her the love and the attachment. He starts washing her feet. He starts feeding her. She was an old lady. He starts taking care of her. And she notices the difference. She tells him, oh, my dear son, Zakaria, what has happened to you? I see that you're acting very different now. What has happened? So he tells her, oh, my mother, I joined the religion of Islam. And I met a man who told me that now that you're a Muslim, referring to Imam Sadiq, now that you're a Muslim, you have to show more love and care and attachment to your mother. So she tells him, is this man a prophet of God? He tells her, no, he's not a prophet, but he is from the progeny of a prophet. He's from the descendants of a prophet. So she says, then I want to be on the same faith and same path as that man. And she joins the religion of Islam and she dies having become a Muslim. So Zakaria ibn Adam, the next time he sees Imam Sadiq, he tells him the story. He tells him that my mother joined the religion of Islam as a result of the way you ordered me to deal with her. Just because you are a Muslim does not mean that you don't respect your parents if they're not Muslim. Or maybe they're not good people. Maybe they're not doing something that's moral, something that's good. You still have to show them that love. You still have to show them that respect and that honor. Now, what are our responsibilities? What are our duties towards our parents? How should they be treated? Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Isra, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَن لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And your Lord has decreed that you do not worship anyone other than Him and you show ihsan to your parents. What is ihsan? Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he says ihsan is that you serve them, you take care of them before they ask you to take care of them. Some people, they take care of their parents because their parents, they're calling them, they're telling them, I need this and I need that. That's not ihsan. Ihsan is when you go and you serve them before they ask you. You see your mother, your father, they want to take medicine, they need a cup of water. Before they get up and they take the water, you go and you bring it to them. You see that they're in need of anything, they need medicine, they need to go to the doctor, they need something. Sometimes parents, because they love their children so much, they don't tell them. They don't tell them when they need something. Sometimes they keep the pain with them. They don't tell their parents. So here Allah says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. When do you have to show that the most? Allah tells us exactly when. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرْ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. Usually your parents, they don't like to burden their children when the parents are well, they're good, they're healthy, they don't need anything. But there comes a time when they become older. That is the time that they are in need of their children. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرْ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. Once they get older, one of them or both of them, here, that is the time that you have to show them ihsan. That is the time that you have to treat them better than anyone else. See, with everyone else, we are ordered to treat people with equality, with adala, justice. If someone, for example, did something to me, I have the right to do the same thing to that person. But if my parents, for example, they were upset with me, they yelled at me, they did something, do I have the right to do the same? No, it's haram. Allah says in the Quran, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. During their life, when they're old, or at any time, don't even say uff to them. You know, sometimes when someone tells you to do something, we make that sound, uff, why do I have to do this? The Quran says, don't even say that to them. The Imam says, if there was anything less than uff, The Quran would have mentioned it. That's something, that's just a gesture that someone makes. You're not saying anything. You're just making that sound. فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Don't yell at them. Don't rebuke them. Don't raise your voice at them. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And when you talk to them, be very kind. Show love. Show attachment. Show respect to them. This is during their life. And then after their death, after they leave this life, وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. Oh Allah, have mercy on my parents, just as they raised me and they had mercy upon me when I was in need of mercy, when I was young. Your parents are in need of your dua, whether they're alive or they have passed on. They are in need of your prayers. And if you want your prayers for yourself to be accepted, then you do dua for your parents. A man asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he tells him, what are my obligations towards my father? Rasulullah tells him, لا تمشي أمامه. You don't walk in front of him. Meaning that you give him the respect. He's the leader. ولا تمشي أمامه. ولا تستسب له. Do not be a reason that people will curse at your father. You know, in some cultures, when they want to curse at someone, they don't just curse at that person. They curse at this person and their father and their grandfather and their whole family. So Rasulullah says, وَلَا تُسْتَسَبْ لَهُ. Don't do something so that people are going to curse your father. وَلَا تُسْتَسَبْ لَهُ. وَلَا تَجْلُسْ قَبْلَهُ. Don't go and sit in front of, before your father. When you arrive somewhere, you make sure your father has the chosen seat. وَلَا تَجْلُسْ قَبْلَهُ. وَلَا تَدَعْهُ بِاسْمِهِ. And you do not call your father by his name. And also all of these apply to the mother as well. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, مَنْ سَرَّهُ. Because once you start doing that, once you start caring for your parents, you're going to see many blessings in your life and in your afterlife. You want, if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase your wealth, you want Allah to increase your life and prolong your life and give you more, then you take care of your parents. There are laws in the, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a system. There are laws. You do something here, God will give you something else. There's a cause and effect. Maybe we don't realize it, but there is a system, and this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points out in the Quran and in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Rasulullah says, مَنْ سَرَّهُ أَنْ يُمَدْ فِي عُمْرِهِ وَيَزْدَادْ فِي رِزْقِهِ فَلْيَمْسِي بَارًا لِوَالِدَيْهِ وَصُولًا لِرَحِمِهِ. If you want, Rasulullah is giving us a formula. If you want to prolong your life and your rizq, your sustenance to be increased, what do you have to do? You have to be بار الوالدين. You have to show love and respect and compassion to your parents. وَصُولًا لِرَحِمِهِ. You have to be connected with your rahim. Anyone that you've shared a womb with, meaning your relatives, anyone that you share blood with, this person, you have to be connected with this person. Now someone, always they come and they say, what about this person? They're disconnected with me. They're disconnected with you. You have to do your task. You do your duty and they have their own responsibility. You do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering you to do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prolong your life if you're good with your family. And on the other hand, anyone who's bad with the family, then this person, their life will be destroyed and their afterlife will also be destroyed. عقوق الوالدين, making your parents angry with you, where they can't sleep the night because they're angry with you and they're really upset with you, that's عاق الوالدين. That will destroy your life. That's a formula for destroying your life and destroying your afterlife. And this person is cursed in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses this person in the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. This is the covenant between God. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَنْ لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. This is something that God has instructed you to do. So this is a covenant that we have with God. So those who break that covenant, those who break that bond, وَالَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. They disconnect the covenant with God. What do they do? وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَن يُوصَلْ وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And they disconnect the relationship that God has told you to connect with your parents, with your family, with your relatives. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And they cause fasad, they cause oppression and tumult in the land. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ اللَّعْنَةِ وَلَهُمْ سُوءُ الدَّارِ. Those are the people that are cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, la'an means someone is barred from the mercy of Allah. The mercy does not come to this person anymore. وَلَهُمْ سُوءُ الدَّارِ. And they have the worst ending. They have the worst house in the afterlife. So we have to be very careful. For some people, this is their test. Some people, they pray, they fast, they go to Hajj, they do everything, but their struggle is with their parents. If that's your test, then you have to know that this is a test that God is testing you with. So you have to be very careful with it. Not to talk back, not to say anything bad, not to say anything that might anger your parents. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, مَن نَظَرَ إِلَىٰ أَبَوَيْهِ نَظَرَ مَاقِتْ وَهُمَا ظَالِمَانْ لَهِ لَمْ يَقْبَلِ اللَّهِ مِنْهُ صَلَاتِ. Subhanallah, this is such a scary hadith where the Imam, he says, if someone is frowning at his parents or her parents, and the parents, they are the wrongdoers, وَهُمَا لَهُ ظَالِمَانِ, they are the ones who are the wrongdoers, لَمْ يَقْبَلِ اللَّهِ مِنْهُ صَلَاتِ, Allah will not accept the prayer of the one who is frowning at the parents. Meaning that even if they are in the wrong, you still have to respect them. Because we mentioned earlier that the biggest wrong, the greatest oppression is associating a partner with Allah. And Allah says, even despite that, you still have to respect your parents. So if they are wronging you, you still have to respect them. You do not reciprocate the same action. That's your duty. That's your responsibility by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the teaching of the religion of Islam. Now, yes, you're not required to obey them in everything that they tell you to do. When am I? Here, scholars, they talk about this. When is it obligatory upon you to obey your parents, and when does it become not obligatory? Here, scholars say that what's haram is to hurt your parents. It's haram to oppress your parents. It's haram to anger your parents. But it's not always wajib to obey them in everything that they do. Because there are some things that they want for you, they like for you, but they're not going to get upset. For example, your father tells you, I want you to become a doctor, like every Middle Eastern parent. I want you to become, you know, someone who's very successful, someone who's very rich. You come and if you didn't do that, are they really going to get upset? Are they really going to hate you for that? Most likely, no. Most of the time, your parents, they want what's for your own success. They want you to be successful. So that's why their point of view of success is someone who's a doctor, someone who's making millions of dollars. When that's not always the case, by the way. The being successful is success in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and someone who makes enough money to be able to take care of their family and live a happy life. You don't need to live an extravagant lifestyle to be happy. But anyways, so imagine if your parents are telling you, this is the job I want you to do. And you couldn't do that. That's not your interest. And it doesn't really hurt them. It doesn't really anger them. But it's something that they liked for you to do. It's not haram. But for example, if your parents are going to get upset and angry and they're going to be, you know, they're not going to want to talk to you anymore because of this, then here you have to try to please your parents in the best way possible. You have to try to please them. But sometimes if your parents are telling you something that you know is wrong, for example, there are some parents when it comes to marriage, they want to force their children to marry someone who the children do not want to marry. That's wrong. And the parents, they need to put their shoes, you know, put themselves in the shoes of their children. At the end of the day, it's your children who are getting married. You can't come and force them to get married to someone from this culture, from this community, from this background. Yes, as a parent, you have a duty to care for the well-being of your children. You have a duty to raise them, to help them make good decisions, but not to make decisions for them. There are some parents, they want to make every single decision for their children. That's also wrong. Let them choose. Let them choose how to live their life, but as a parent, you have to guide them and you have to show them the way. So, it's haram to hurt them, but always listening to them, sometimes they're not going to get upset. If they're not going to get upset, then it's okay to not do what they're asking you to do. Now, sometimes even if there's something good that you want to do, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the Muslims were going out for jihad to sacrifice in the way of Allah and to defend the Muslims. A young man, he comes to the Prophet and he tells him, I want to come, but I'm the only son of my parents and they want me to stay with them. Rasulullah tells him, you stay with your parents. And then Rasulullah says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَأُنْسُهُمَا بِكَ يَوْمًا وَلَيْلَةً خَيْرٌ مِّن جِهَادِ سَنَةٍ. I swear by the one who my soul is in his hand, meaning God, your parents' happiness with you one day and one night is better, will give you greater reward with Allah than jihad in the way of Allah for one full year. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. And the satisfaction of the parents is very important. It's important for this life and for the afterlife and during the moments of death. If someone, their parents are angry with them, that moment is going to be very difficult for them. I'll conclude with this story. During the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, there was a man who was dying, a young man who was dying. So the Muslims, they came and they told Rasulullah, this man is in the process of dying, but he's not dying, he's suffering. He's not able to speak, he's not able to say anything, he's just suffering. So Rasulullah comes, because Rasulullah is a mercy. Rasulullah, he stands over this person and he tells him, say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, but this person's is in a different world. This person, he cannot speak, his tongue is tied, he can't speak. So Rasulullah, he looks around, he says, are his parents around? They say his mother is around. He calls his mother, he tells her, are you satisfied with your son? She tells Rasulullah, to be honest with you, no, I'm not satisfied with him. He says, why? She tells him, this son of mine, I cared for him, I raised him, I helped him, I was crying for him, I did everything for him. As soon as he became older, he started abusing me, he started harassing me, he would lay his hands at me, and this broke my heart. He got married, he started favoring his wife over me, and he started yelling at me, he's always oppressing me, I'm not happy with him. So Rasulullah, he tells her, because you're not happy with him, that is the reason why this person is not able to speak. So please, be happy with him, be pleased with him, ask Allah to forgive him. She says, Ya Rasulullah, I can't. I'm too hurt. He really hurt me. It's been many years where he's been oppressing me. All he does is abuse me after all that I did to him. I can't. So then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he sees that he has no choice but to teach her and show her a lesson. And to teach her that her anger towards her son will cause him to suffer, and to teach other people that when your parents are angry with you, that will cause you to suffer. So Rasulullah, he tells the Muslims, bring some firewood, gather some firewood. They gather some firewood and the mother is watching. And then he tells them, light the fire. They light a fire, and then Rasulullah, he tells the people, he says, carry this young man and throw him in the fire. As soon as Rasulullah says that, the mother says, Ya Rasulullah, what are you doing? You want to burn my own son? This is my son, this is my baby. He tells her, you're a mother. When you are not satisfied with your son, this is how your son is going to be burnt in a fire that is much more severe than this fire. So she realizes, she says, then I'm happy with him. Then I'll be satisfied with him. And this is the mercy of a mother. Then the young man, he was able to speak. So Rasulullah comes to him. He tells him, what do you see? He says, I see an ugly image of a person choking me, holding my neck and choking me, and I can't speak. So then Rasulullah, he tells him, repeat after me this dua. Ya man yaqbalu al-yaseer wa ya'fu an al-kathir. Iqbal minni al-yaseer wa'fu anni al-kathir. Oh, he who accepts the little and forgives the many sins that we have done. Accept the little that I have and forgive the many that I the many wrongs that I have. يا من يقبل اليسير ويعفو عن الكثير اقبل مني اليسير واعفو عني الكثير. Rasulullah kept telling the young man to repeat that. Then Rasulullah tells him, what do you see now? He says, I see that that image is going away and a beautiful image is coming to me. And then the man was able to finally say the shahada. He was finally able to say the kalimatu shahada, and the man died. This shows us the importance of the parents being happy with you. Now, one final point. Sometimes the parents, and we have a hadith regarding this, it says that if you're a parent, don't force your children to become aq with you. Meaning, don't put your children in a circumstance, in a situation where you're going to have to be angry with them. Some parents, they do that. They put their children, they corner them, they put them in a situation where their children would be forced to disobey the parents. There's actually a hadith which says, may the curse of Allah be upon a parent that does that to their children. Because you are going to be the reason that you're barring your children from the mercy of Allah. You're putting them in a tough circumstance. Yes, because when they anger you, they're going to suffer. Not only in this life and in the afterlife. And finally, the last point, we have a duty towards our parents in this life and in the afterlife. And after they've died, after they've left this life. Some people, they say, oh, my parents are not alive anymore. That means I don't have responsibilities towards my parents anymore. No, that's not the case. You still have responsibilities towards your parents. In a hadith from Rasulullah, he says, سيد الأبرار يوم القيامة رجل بر والديه بعد موتهما. The person who's the most بار الوالدين, most connected to parents, is the one who showed respect and love and attachment to parents after their death. Meaning that you keep doing dua for them, you keep giving charity on their behalf, you keep doing good things that are good on their behalf. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله الطاهرين. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us be from the ones who are بار الوالدين, who are connected and respectful to our parents. اللهم أدخل على أهل القبور السرور, اللهم أغني كل فقير, اللهم أشبع كل جائع, اللهم اكسو كل عريان, اللهم اقضي دينا كل مدين, اللهم فرج عن كل مكروب, اللهم رد كل غريب, اللهم فك كل أسير, اللهم أصلح كل فاسد من أمور المسلمين, اللهم اشفي كل مريض, اللهم سد فقرنا بغناك, اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك, اللهم اقض عنا الدين وأغننا من الفقر, إنك على كل شيء قدير. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نهدي ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلوات. اللهم صل